Okay, so, well, welcome everyone to this workshop. So today we're going to be talking about how to navigate a virtual career fair, which a lot of what we'll be talking about will cover obviously for when we get back to in-person events. And my name is Lauren Trolland. I'm Assistant Director in Career Services, and I have here today one of our employer guests, Carla Lynch from Arbella. And Carla, if you'd like to introduce yourself and a little bit about your background and Arbella itself.
Sure. So Carla Lynch, I'm the Talent Acquisition Manager for Arbella Insurance Group. So my team, we're really excited to manage all of the talent needs, you know, for the organization around staffing. So I've been in human resources for over 25 years and really enjoy it and love, you know, the staffing piece and bringing great people into our organization. Arbella, we are a property and casualty insurance organization headquartered in Quincy, Massachusetts.
Awesome, thank you. So let me just get the presentation up. So we're going to go through, we have a presentation with some slides, and I will email this to all of you afterwards so that you have a copy of that as well. And once the link is up, it'll be on our office YouTube channel, so you can pop that up at any time if you want to go back and take a look through that. So let me just get my screen going here. Hang on one second. All right, did it switch over to the PowerPoint presentation, Carla?
Sure, yep, got okay. It.
All right, awesome. So as we're going through today in the presentation, couple main things to be thinking about as we're gearing up, and I apologize if I'm looking off the side, I have the two screens, so sometimes I'm back and forth on there, but when you're thinking about prepping for career fair, job fair, whatever you call it, an in-person networking event with employers, it's first important to kind of be thinking about what the target is and really be thinking about your overall purpose going into one of these events. So for the employer side, it could be at some different levels. Most are obviously going to have open jobs and internships, maybe part-time roles, occasionally project-based work, co-ops, things like that that they may have available. And typically they're going to get resumes on there and to instruct you on next steps. So oftentimes they may say apply online, and that's not putting you up, that's just part of what the process is. But by getting the resume and that face-to-face time, you're having an opportunity to have a conversation and become a known person versus just another resume that's coming in. And of course, organizations need to tell you about who they are. And that's important for you as well as candidates, because you need to determine, is this going to be a place that you want to apply to, that you want to interview at, making sure that it's a good overall fit. So just don't discount that part of it, you know, take information. So if they're emailing you with these virtual events, they might be emailing you links to information or PDFs of details about their organization after the fact. So make sure you definitely take a look through that. So you'll be gathering that information and getting contacts. I know in a normal event, we'd be telling you, you know, get those business cards, but during these events, jot down email addresses, ask for their contact information. Make sure you have that so you can still do your follow-up, which we'll talk about. So find out about their openings, but don't just stop there. You know, you might look and say, oh, this, you know, State Street's only posting, you know, two roles right now, but they're a huge organization. So chances are they're gonna have more opportunities that are gonna be available down the line. So don't hesitate to talk about and ask about future openings. Do they anticipate things that are coming? What are the timelines for maybe some of their maybe internship programs or things like that? It's that chance. And these events too are also great chances to work on those networking and interviewing type skills before you get in the hot seat and meeting one-on-one with the employer for the actual interview for the role. This is a chance to, if you've never gone through maybe a formal interview process, to have some of that experience on there. So it gives you some of that insight. And so Carla, from your perspective, how do you think of it as career fairs? You know, kind of what are maybe some of your top goals as you're going into the room, or in this case, into the Zoom room or something?
Sure, Sure, absolutely. You know, our key goals is when we either go on site, you know, to meet with students or virtual, it's all about, you know, meeting students, getting to know them and finding great talent, you know, for the organization. I mean, definitely one of my favorite parts of the job is to be working with college students. You know, whether it's somebody who's going to be graduating in the spring or, you know, somebody who's just out there, you know, looking at different organizations, different industries, different cultures to really find, you know, that right fit for themselves when they get ready to graduate or thinking about, you know, an internship. So for us, you know, we love, you know, getting out there, like I said, meeting with great students, you know, getting to know them, getting to know their backgrounds, what types of things that they're looking for, whether it's a certain position or, you know, what are they looking for when they think about, you know, that first job. So we love to kind of gather a lot of that information in addition to talking about Arbella and what we offer, you know, our students. We hire a lot of, you know, college grads every year. And it's definitely, you know, one of the most favorite parts of my position, you know, for sure.
Awesome. Thank you. All right. So as you're going through and thinking, so we've already kind of thought about what is going to be that start of the game plan, thinking of what is your goal and purpose. Now is to start to pull together what you need to be successful during the event. So at any Career Fair networking event, you should have a resume that's put together. Now, these virtual events, when we're going to talk about it, it allows you on Handshake to upload your resume so that way an employer can pull it up right from the account. But if you don't have it up there right away the day of, just get the employer's contact information and you can email it after the fact. So just keep that in mind. You know, if you don't have the time, you can, of course, ask for the contact information, follow up with them, and also they'll most likely need you to apply online. But a few things when you're thinking about the resume. Now, when I show you a little bit later on our website where we have our resume writing guide, it'll give you some samples and things to look at if you haven't gone through and worked on your resume before. But a couple big things is that you're trying to market the background that's going to be important to the employers you're going to be talking to. So obviously your education degree backgrounds, the jobs, internships that you've had, both related and unrelated, depending on the room on your resume. Definitely talk about your extracurricular activities and volunteer experiences on the resume. And of course, depending on the particular industry, any certifications that you may need, technical skills, foreign language capabilities, those are all things that could be highlighted on the resume. So we encourage you to go with a blank Word document, you know, try to avoid the templates. I know Word pushes out these two column templates a lot now, which some industries it works for, but not all. So if you're just kind of starting out, a single column, you know, blank Word document's probably best. Simple, easy to use fonts. You don't have to use Times or Calibri, any of the presets. There's tons of fonts, but just make sure it's easy to read and it's a good size on there. Then making sure it's carefully organized so that way, you know, if you put dates in one place, they don't move all around on the resume. If you're using punctuation, you don't start in one place and don't have it in the rest. So making sure it has a careful organization. Of course, checking for spelling errors and grammatical errors. Now, if you're going through and doing an edit on your own, we also recommend reading from the bottom up so you're a little bit more likely to catch some of those errors that you have. And at any time, you can always call the office to schedule an appointment for a virtual resume review with a career counselor. We do have limited appointments available before the career fair, so I would be calling as soon as possible with that. But if you need it as a follow-up, of course, you know, we have our regular office hours, Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, when you can schedule an appointment to meet with a counselor. And again, we really encourage you to upload it onto Handshake, so that way it can be available, because as the employer gets ready to log in to the meeting room with you at the career fair, they can click on your profile and see your resume is already there, so they could have it up and open while they're having a conversation with you. So it just makes things a little bit easier from there. So, and Carla, you know, some other tips maybe for resumes from your perspective, things that really make them stand out as at the career fair, maybe both positive and maybe a few things for candidates to watch out for?
Yeah, I think really one of the key things is that the resume is just clean, crisp, and just really easy to read. I think that's one of the key things, because typically, you know, a recruiter is really only looking at that resume for, you know, a very short span of time. So they really need to be able to pull out very quickly, you know, what your work experience is, you know, what your background is, the degree that you're working towards. They want to be able to, you know, get that information as quickly as possible. So I think the resumes that are just very simple, easy to read. I think one page is critical, I think, especially, you know, for somebody kind of coming right out of college. I think if you have multiple pages, that's typically for somebody that has, you know, quite a bit of work experience. So one page, really, you know, easy to read, is really important. And as mentioned, you know, making sure that you really add those items in there around the college activities, or even just like part-time positions that you've had, volunteer positions, if you've gotten any different types of awards or scholarships, you know, those are great things to remember, to put on the resume, because that really just says a lot about who you are, how you work, and it just gives a lot more indication about, you know, your background. So including those items is important.
Great. And I will make sure also when I send out the follow-up with the presentation, I'll include the resume packet so you all have that as well. So great. So you'll be working on making updates to the resume. And if you're unable to get in and meet with a counselor, I would just definitely encourage you to have a friend or family member do a round through edit with you. And that can definitely help to catch some general errors and things like that. And you can always follow up with us after the fact if that works best for your schedule. Now, beyond the resume, there's a few other items that you need to think about preparing for career fairs. So any fair this goes for, it's one of the biggest things that doesn't happen is careful research prior to going in about the organizations you're going to be talking to. So when I go and show you a little bit later, you know, what everything looks like for the career fair on Handshake, you want to go through there, take a look and see, you know, what are the available positions. Go to their website, check them out a little bit, see, you know, are they in the industry you're looking for? Do they do the type of things that you're hoping to do? Do you see career growth? So on and so forth. Have a couple things in mind. So if they ask you at the event, what do you know about us? What made you want to have a meeting with us today? You'll have some things that you'll be able to talk about with them. Now, the second bullet point doesn't necessarily apply to this virtual career fair necessarily, because I know you'll be looking at the virtual schedule, plugging in times that are available and works for you. But what I would say is that is to prioritize as best you can the organizations that interest you. So if you have your top place and you're feeling a little bit nervous, you've never done this before, maybe your number one choice shouldn't be that very first, you know, meeting or booth you go up to in a physical career fair. Maybe go to ones that are maybe, you know, third on your list or something like that. Start there to get a little bit of those nerves out, to feel a little bit more confident, so that when you get to maybe that place you've always thought you wanted to work for your entire life, you've had that chance to get some of those nerves kind of out of the way there. But make sure you look through, as I already kind of said, look through their website, see about what they do, dig a little bit in their history, know about their locations, look into what their competitors are, Google them to see what's coming up recently with news for maybe accolades, maybe new programs, new facilities they're adding. Those are all good things to have some awareness of when talking to an employer. And take those notes, have those ready, and especially in a virtual fair component, you can kind of have your little cheat sheet out with you that you can look at right before you get on the call to kind of bring up those things of memory. And you can definitely jot down questions that you have, because most employers will ask if you have any questions, and it's fine to ask, you know, for clarification about things that maybe you found on the website. And you should. This is also your chance to figure out, is this going to be a good place to go? So obviously doing a company Google search, but there are sites that are great, like Glassdoor.com. If you haven't used that before, that's a major corporation website that people put reviews on, salary information, interview questions. It gives some really good information and research that you could do. But There's other sites like idealist.org that are big in the nonprofit sector. And of course, LinkedIn has a lot of great research tools that are out there as well. So again, doing that sort of careful research on there. And Carla, any thoughts in that area?
Doing the preparation work is just so critical and so important for you to really show up, you know, with your best foot forward, you know, in that conversation. So, you know, just looking at some of these key things just around like their business, their mission statement, you know, recent news, you know, just looking at a small amount of information here, just so you can talk intelligently about, you know, the organization is really important. I mean, you don't need to have like the annual report memorized or, you know, any of those types of things, but you're just really understanding like what they do, maybe a little bit about their culture, and some of these, you know, key items can really help you stand out, because it just shows that you are doing your homework. It shows that you care, that you're interested. And again, you want to be able to stand out. So really doing a little bit of that homework is really important. And I think also, you know, looking at Glassdoor, you can get lots of great insight, or just general Google searches. You can get a lot of great feedback and insight, you know, on the organization. You know, what are the employees, you know, how do the employees feel about the company, the culture, the different jobs that are available. And I think the other point here, which I really like that's on this slide, is, you know, do not limit your priority list. You know, there might be other, you know, organizations or other industries that you might not have thought about, you know, researching, but they might be, you know, something worth, you know, looking into. So I think being open to, you know, industries and organizations that you may not have thought about, you know, could definitely lead to some, you know, great conversation and some potential positions.
Awesome. Yeah, and to that point too, with these virtual fairs, a lot, many companies are doing group information sessions. So maybe if you're not certain that you want to do a one-on-one meeting because you're not 100% sure about the organization, that's a great way in this sort of environment to be able to go learn a little bit, see if it could potentially be a good fit. And then you could always follow up. I'm sure all the organizations are going to give the list of contact information, next steps and everything. So you'll still be able to get some of that follow-up with organizations. So great. So you'll do that careful research. And then this kind of leads to everybody's big question of what on earth do I say when I start talking to these individuals? Now, with a virtual career fair, it will be a little bit slightly different. You know, you're not walking up to a table or waiting in line to kind of queue up. You're just popping into a virtual chat room with an organization. Now, most likely, you know, these are seasoned recruiters and HR managers who are probably going to get the ball rolling with the conversation, but oftentimes the opener is going to be something like we're talking about here. Tell me about yourself. And this comes to your elevator pitch, your elevator speech. So this is what we encourage all candidates to work on and have thought of in advance. So that way, when you get that opener question, you're not just feeling like a deer in headlights. You've got that information that you're ready to introduce who you are briefly to get the ball rolling on the conversation. And most likely from there, it's going to go into a lot of Q&A back and forth. You know, employers asking about your work history, you asking some questions about the organization. It'll become a little bit more organic as you get into it, but starting out with the elevator pitch, these are usually 30 to 60 seconds long that you're working on. And it is answering that question, tell me about yourself. Now, it's not your life story. It's basically kind of going through your education background, skill sets, experiences that qualify you for this role, and what interested you in wanting to talk to them, which goes back to that research that we're talking about. So some things that you can be thinking about is, who are you in terms of a potential employee? What are the things that you can bring to the table that's relevant for that organization? When we say what you've done that relates to your future plans, how do you relate maybe the internship, the jobs and things you've had? And even if you've just had, you know, part-time jobs, there's still skill sets that'll be important in most industries that you can draw out and talk about, even if you haven't had a chance for that internship yet in that industry. I like the third point. What makes you different from everyone else? What are those unique factors? So if you held down, you know, a full-time job while working full-time and you were involved in, you know, extracurricular activities, you're going to want to sell that. An employer would hear that and go, oh, wow, you can balance, you know, an 80-hour a week schedule. And he said, you're still getting, you know, a 3.5 GPA. That's somebody I'm going to guess that Carla and others would probably want to talk to as they're going through there. And of course, the kind of next step. So based on your research, so if you're talking to Carla or Bella or a recruiter from Citrin Cooperman, you should have looked and seen, you know, what the options are that they have available and kind of through your research talk about, you know, why you're interested in the particular roles they have and how you could see yourself maybe starting a career within the organization. So now just bring up briefly while we talk more about it, it's just a sample speech. I won't read through it. You can kind of read through on the screen as we kind of go through some other thoughts, but I would just map out this sort of brief introduction. And this is just a quick sample. Obviously yours can be a little bit more in detail. This is probably like a 15-second elevator speech versus a 30 or 60 second, but just gives an idea of introducing academic background, two or three reasons, skill sets or experiences that make you a good fit for the organization. And again, kind of leading it into that next step. So Carla, from your perspective, you know, as you hire and as you meet with candidates at these events, you know, has there been things that people have said or ways they go about this that really makes them stand out?
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. I think it's students that really talk about some of the key things that I think are so important in a lot of the kind of the entry level positions, such as, you know, I have good time management skills. So again, you know, as you mentioned, you could say, you know, I managed, you know, full time, you know, job in addition to going to school. So I really needed to manage my time, you know, very effectively. Or people that, you know, talk about their great, you know, customer service skills or communication skills, which is a lot that you learn, whether you are working in like retail or restaurants or, you know, any of those types of things, that background can be really, really helpful, you know, to really enhance communication skills, customer service skills, problem solving skills. So, you know, so many of the different things that you do, whether it's part-time jobs or some of the things that you learn during your, you know, any of your college activities, whether it's, you know, in different types of, you know, you were an RA and you had to do lots of like problem solving and team building, or if you played a sport, you know, so many of those types of activities really teach you a lot of great skills that you can transfer into the workplace. So really thinking about, you know, those experiences at college and in work that you're doing, or even just volunteer work, and how do they translate, you know, to the workforce? So again, you know, work ethic, time management, problem solving, communication skills, customer service skills. Again, those are a lot of the fundamentals that I think a lot of organizations look for in their new, you know, college hires. So really being able to think of some of those examples and to relay it in a passionate, energetic way, I think can set you apart.
Okay. So you'll think about the elevator pitch, and this is something too that should also be customized a bit to the organization. You know, imagine you're at a job fair in person and you went to like six booths all in a row. If you said the same exact thing over and over again, all in earshot, it wouldn't be the best. So think of this almost like your cover letter, where you're always kind of making some updates and adapting it to your audience. That should be what you're thinking about. So skill sets, it may be similar from place to place, but my guess is there's always probably going to be a different experience that you want to touch upon with different organizations so that it kind of hits home to them. So make sure you kind of plot that out. You don't have to have it all, you know, fully rehearsed, but get some general bullet points down in mind that you can do a little practice with so that you feel confident going in and that you won't go, oh, you know, blanking out, you'll feel nervous. This will just make sure that as you start the conversation, you can feel confident. Now, dress attire. So in this current age, some of the things of all this are a little bit different. However, we still strongly encourage all candidates, when you're getting into this video interviewing, video career fair format, that you should still take professional attire into account. Now, it means right now, if you don't have that matching two-piece suit, but you got the shirt and tie or something like that, or the nice blouse or sweater or something like that, I don't think there's an employer who feels like you need to go run out this day and age to go get measured for a suit or anything like that. So it's really about, you know, professional, putting that professional foot forward. And we've all seen enough of the funny things that have happened this day and age with news anchors from remote locations still wearing gym shorts with, you know, a suit jacket over the top. So going for the full outfit, basically, for this to avoid if the camera falls or you have to stand up to grab something. We don't want any snafus that are occurring. So still well put together. You know, if you've got the two-piece matching suit, great, but making sure, you know, again, professional shirt attire, you know, sweaters can be perfectly great to go over, you know, a dress shirt as it gets cooler in the year. But some other things in general for in person too, of course, is, you know, wearing, you know, dress shoes with dress socks or with hose that go with it. No, you know, big heels or anything like that. Making sure that when you have belts, they match in terms of the color and things like that. But basically just making sure that we've got a well put together outfit, hair's done nice. If you've got facial hair, it's either shaved or you've got a very clean shaven look. It's just, again, about keeping that professional appearance as much as possible, even when dealing with a camera for the whole time during the interview. Any other thoughts with dress attire for?
Yeah, no, I think this is super important because, again, you want to have your best foot forward. And this is your brand, right? That, you know, the organization is going to learn about. So, you know, having that professional, you know, polished look, especially, you know, even now in with video, you know, interviews, you know, someone that is in a suit and professionally dressed, you know, again, you're going to really, you know, do well in the interview. So I think it's really important.
All right. Now, also important is, especially now, normally obviously be saying what to bring with you, but now it's preparing your total space. So couple main things is make sure you've got pad of paper or something, tablet, whatever to take notes on, that you got your questions, or if you got multiple screens over, whatever works for you, have that. Have your resume opened up on your computer so you can go back and forth and mention things. If they allow you to screen share, great, you can do that, or be ready to email it right off to them. Have your phone turned off, or as I often find when I'm trying to record things for our office YouTube channels, I leave Outlook open and things start dinging or stuff comes up. So take care of all of those items. Quiet location as best as possible. You can never plan on when the neighbor's gonna get the leaf blower out, but do your best in terms of that. Test the Wi-Fi. You know, we all know certain places in our houses, apartments, whatever, have better reception. So just really try to find the best spot as you can and beg friends or family members in where you're living to not all be streaming at that same moment that you're trying to go on. Now, neutral background. So I pick a random corner in my dining room because it's got a pretty blank background. You know, it's not right in a window where, you know, you're distracted by things that are going on outside. I try to close the blinds a little bit so there's not too much light and dark. Unfortunately, these are things you'll have to play around a little bit within your space to make sure that it works good. Test the software in advance. Make sure you've got the updated version of the browser. You allow access to the cam and microphone. You test all of that in advance. So just like I mentioned for the Handshake software, there's a quick web tool that you can use that'll test everything on there to make sure you're good to go. We always encourage that in advance. And making sure that you're looking at, and it's always hard for me in any of these when I'm looking at notes on a screen, but looking at the webcam and not necessarily the faces on the screen. So what you might want to do is put a little post-it note over where your camera is with a little smiley face on it and try and make that where you draw your eye attention to, just to make sure that you're giving the good eye contact versus looking down the entire time. And I know it'll happen, but it's just one of those things to do your best to try to monitor it as much as you can. Mm-hmm. Other thoughts on the kind of preparing of the space or any other issues you've seen when interviewing or talking to candidates so far?
Yeah, and again, I think this preparation is so important, because when you do all of this, you're gonna have more confidence again that it's gonna all go, you know, really well and really smoothly. There are times, you know, we've had those situations where, you know, the Wi-Fi goes down, or, you know, the dog runs into the room, or, you know, those types of things. And, you know, we do understand, of course, you know, from time to time, those types of things happen. But as best as you can, really trying to set up, you know, kind of that professional, clean environment, you know, for the interview is really, really important. Kind of looking at the background, making sure that it's appropriate, you know, testing equipment, all these different types of things will help you, you know, have a successful meeting.
Okay. So basically what I'm gonna say is doing your best on all of this is really what it boils down to in this environment. So then when we get to the point of the actual, I guess we shouldn't say physical event, but the actual virtual fair. Take a look at the schedule in advance, and I'll show you on Handshake in a bit where you can find all that information. And as you schedule, it will keep a track for you of all the times. And really any of these virtual fair software systems will work the same. So what you want to do is schedule in advance as much as possible so you can organize your notes and have everything ready. If you're not pre-scheduling everything, determine still, take a look at the list of those attending and know who you want to talk to. Or if maybe you scheduled a handful of sessions and you got a little free time, again, go back to that list to see what are some other potential options. If you blocked off 2 hours for this event and you got 20 extra minutes, you might as well fill that up with two more potential organizations that you could chat with, or again, one of those info sessions that you can get some info just to see if it is a place that you want to talk to, if maybe you're a little bit on the fence. I already kind of talked about not approaching necessarily your top choices first. We already covered through that. Reviewing your notes and questions for that employer prior to the meeting. Now, these will be a bit back to back because of the way the system goes. It's kind of like 10-minute blocks. So you need to have everything kind of ready to go. So with this especially, I would make sure that you've reviewed your notes in advance and maybe kind of have it either separate pieces of paper or kind of clearly delineated so you can kind of turn your attention quickly to that. And again, that good eye contact throughout is going to be important as best as you can, trying to control that overall. Mm-hmm. You will be trying to make sure that you're greeting the recruiters with a smile, clear voice, and that you prepared that elevator speech so that if they start right off with that, tell me about yourself question, you're ready to go. You'll have questions from your list ready to go to ask them. And really, most things are fine to talk about. You know, if you, like this one saying, you know, if you found something about the position that you wanted more clarification about, if you wanted to know about their onboarding or training process. Now, I'd probably wait on, you know, questions about salary or benefits until you get, you know, farther into the process, but they may disclose some of that information to you or provide you a little bit of details from the point of their booth. Now with time, this is also more for your benefit because with the Handshake piece, your one-on-ones are 10 minutes. And again, they're kind of back to back. So keep an eye on that time. You know, if you got a huge question and you're at 9 minutes and 10 seconds, you should probably say, would it be possible for me to email you with some other questions that I have? Just so that way you don't run into being late for your next one or have the employer behind for their next meeting. So as much as possible, keep an eye on that. Just like an in-person event, you know, they've got people to talk to in line. You don't want to take 20 minutes on there. Definitely, definitely ask about next steps. What's the process like to apply, to interview, hiring, and all that? What you would need to do to be included in that process, any deadline dates, jot all that down and make sure you follow up with that. Get their contact information and don't forget important things of thank you, just ending a conversation on a polite note there. Those are always things that you want to take into account, whether it's an in-person or virtual event.
And I would just like to add, you know, I think it's helpful just to remember that, you know, these types of meetings is, it's really you telling your story, you know, and I think sometimes that makes it a little bit easier for people when they just go into the meeting and feeling like, you know, here I am just kind of telling my story about my background, you know, my education, work history, you know, all those different types of things. And really selling that, you know, part of this is really selling your background, selling who you are, selling all the great qualities and talents that you're going to bring, you know, to the position. So trying to, you know, bring that positive energy, bring that passion, you know, to that meeting, I think it is really important. And again, that can help set you apart, you know, telling that passion or telling that story with a lot of passion and a lot of great energy.
And kind of going off of that is there's more to do after the fair. So kind of that way to demonstrate your passion, your energy, and your interests on there is the steps after the fair. And a big part of that, I'll come to in a moment, is the thank you note or letter. But a couple things is, first, jot down notes, as we said, as you're going along, but also, you know, take down some finalized notes. That way, if you're going on an interview, you'll already have some things to go back with. Always, anytime somebody's spending time with you, whether an in-person interview, virtual career fair in person, always send some sort of thank you. Now, you know, an email thank you is perfectly acceptable. I would just say get that out within, you know, that same day or the next business day. If the hiring time frame is a bit down the road and you want to go with a handwritten or typed up and signed thank you, that can be great too. Only thing is you'd want to double check about contact information, because if people are working from home, obviously their office address that they may have on their PowerPoint slide, they may have forgotten to check that. So just, you know, double check that when before you send that out to make sure that they do get that. But definitely say, especially right now, an email thank you would be perfectly appropriate, and not enough people do that. So we're trying to think of all these professional niceties, these extras, to help try and push you over the edge of being somebody that an employer would think about. Then go and apply online to any positions that interest if they told you to do that. Again, that's not putting you off, but every single organization needs you in their tracking system, their HR system, whatever one they use. They need you in there to be able to pull you through the rest of the process. But if they have your resume and notes for meeting with you the fair, typically most of these systems allow them to flag you as somebody that they already met with. So again, it's not being put off. It's just a standard part of the process. Participate in any follow-up recommendations they make. So they may say, hey, your skill sets are best for this other position. Let me connect you with my colleague. Make sure you follow up, get that person's info, connect on LinkedIn, however you need to. And of course, bookmarking the organization's website, any postings that they have, or following them on Handshake or any other sites, just so that you're aware of any new opportunities that come in if you've decided to target them at an organization. And as I pull up just a quick sample here, any other thoughts, Carla, on thank you notes?
Yeah, no, I think the thank you note is really, really important. And I oftentimes get comments from like the hiring managers when they see a really nice thank you note, you know, a thank you note that is very personalized, that talks about some of the things that they discussed in the meeting. It can really, again, set you apart. So I think, you know, sending, you know, that email thank you note right away is important. And then if you can, you know, as mentioned, you know, follow up with a written thank you note, because again, it just shows you're doing a little extra, you know, you're writing that handwritten note, you're putting it in the mail. It just, again, shows, you know, who you are, and again, can set you apart.
Right. Okay. All right. And some final reminders before we get into taking a look at how this all looks on Handshake and, of course, to your questions. Just going back through the major points, review and research in advance. Know who you're targeting. And with these virtual fairs, we highly, highly encourage you to schedule in advance so that A, they don't get all booked up and you don't have a spot to meet with them. And so that B, you can have a time that works for you. Because one of the benefits of this is maybe being able to squeeze things in between, you know, doing your virtual classwork or getting to your full-time job or whatever, it should hopefully help you allow to fit these things in a little easier. Professional attire, have your resume ready to go, reviewed, critiqued, and again, worst case scenario, at least have a friend or family member look through. Have some questions prepared to ask the employer things that you want some clarification and to know about, because most will ask if you have questions and you don't want to just have that blank look and not having anything to ask. Make sure you prepare and practice your elevator speech a little bit. Again, like we said, doesn't have to be 100% rehearsed, but you want to think about it a little bit. Be on time for these sessions, especially when they're back to back. Now, I know if you've got back to back, you can't immediately be in there super early, but most in the handshake system will allow you to join most group sessions 5 minutes in advance. And if the employer is already in the one-on-one room, it'll allow you to go in a few minutes before. So that way, if you're both ready and available to go, you can get right into the conversation. They can let you in the room and you can move forward to hopefully allow you to maybe finish up a little bit early. Now with these back-to-backs, if you have room, try to schedule some time in between. So don't try to do 12, 10-minute sessions all back-to-back. It's probably not going to go super well for you if you're doing that much over and over again. So we always say try to at least schedule a pause, at least in the middle of it or something, to give you a little bit of that time to relax, take a moment, collect your thoughts, put some notes aside and everything, and be ready. And of course, follow up with organizations that are going to be of interest to you. So make sure you do that next step follow up. Now I'm going to close out of the screen so I can start to see, because I couldn't see any of the questions or anything. So let me just get back over to my screen here. So Carla, while I'm kind of getting my screen situated here and get back to the next thing I wanted to show, are there any other thoughts or things that you had that we didn't bring up for the presentation at this point?
No, I think definitely those are all the key points for sure. And I think that sometimes some of these fundamentals is what some of the candidates, you know, kind of either forget or don't, you know, follow through on. I think, again, like the preparation piece, really understanding what the organization does, you know, having some insight about the job that you're looking for, you know, reading that job description, all those types of things, again, are super, super important. I mean, sometimes I have candidates in front of me that, you know, will ask me questions, which, like, you know, clearly I can tell that, you know, they haven't really done, you know, their research. And that really it's not going to put you in a very favorable light. So doing a lot of these great fundamentals, again, can really help set you apart as a candidate.
Okay, great. All right, so as I'm going through, so just as a reminder too, if you do have any questions, I'm going to show you all in a moment, you know, just how things look on Handshake. So if you haven't been in there yet for the virtual fair, you have an idea of what that all looks like. But again, if you have questions, go into the chat box and type them in. We'll leave some time at the end on there. And so if you haven't done that on a Teams meeting yet, let me see if it'll actually show my screen. Yeah, I went over to the other piece. Never mind. But basically, at the top of your screen, you should see the little hide conversation. When you scroll over, it should be next to like the little raise hand icon. So feel free to put in there. But when we're done, if that's not working, I can always unmute everybody if people have some questions that they want to go through. So now let me share you my screen so I can show what things look like on the student end for Handshake. And Carla, are you seeing the Handshake screen come up now?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
So on here, so when you log into Handshake, where you'll be able to get through, if you haven't gone through the event now, we've shared the hyperlink and that'll bring you right there. But otherwise, you can go to events here or there. It'll pull up everything and the fair might pop right up, but otherwise right up top, put in the filter for a career fair. That'll bring you to the event page. And if you haven't already, first thing is you must click on register. So that way that'll start and then it'll say, hey, now you should start signing up for organizations. So as I say, what's next? View employer sessions. So this will pull you to the available sessions tab. And if you come back at another time, just come to available sessions, and this will give you what the organizations are offering. So as I was mentioning, there are group informational sessions. These are typically 30 minutes long and are just what they sound like, organizations giving you that overview of what they do, going through the details, hiring processes, next steps, all of that stuff. So if you're interested in those, you can see the details and you would just confirm that onto your schedule. Now the one-on-ones, again, these are 10-minute time slots with one of the organization recruiters that you can have that individualized conversation, basically kind of just like you're walking up to them at an in-person booth. You can drop down to show all available times. Now it's not on here because I obviously am not registered, but if you see a little red dot near anything, it means you already set up something during that time and it won't let you schedule 2 2:00 meetings. But if not, you'd be able to click right on to the one that you want and then confirm, which I'm not going to do now because I don't want to mess up the schedule, but it would just then plug into what your calendar is going to be. And so you can go through and see, and maybe you're not familiar with certain organizations, but that's the opportunity that you could take a little bit more of a look into them. And I'll show you where you can do all that research in a moment. But as you can see, this is where you can go through to schedule. Your sessions then will all be tagged over here. So I don't have any open, oh, let me just schedule one real quick so it'll show up there. So then what you'll see is you'll have multiple things most likely, but it's showing right now, hey, I've got 2.5 hours that are empty. Let's look at some other options. But here I've registered for a 4:30 informational session. And you'll see the link right here, join video. When it's grayed, it means obviously it's not happening yet, or it's not time, or the employer hasn't logged in yet. When it's available day of, when, you know, a few minutes before 4:30 hits, this should go purple, and then you would just click on it, and instead of this, you would get the launch screen. It would open up into a new tab or window for you to launch that particular piece there. So just cancel that session so it doesn't mess anybody up. Now the career fair details tab, this I'm going to update the morning of the fair with a few more important like day of things like, oh, if you're having trouble with X, Y, and Z, but big one right here, test your software. This link, and I'm not going to click it because it's going to launch a whole thing, but this is going to test your computer, make sure it's got everything it needs. It'll check your camera, microphone, all of that to make sure you're good to go to run the event the day of. If you get errors, then you'll have to take a look and see if your camera's working or things like that. But below here on this career fair details tab will be the list of all the employers attending, and just click for all. And this will allow you to basically, you know, if you've ever attended one of our in-person fairs before, when we give out the guides, that's basically what this is. This will give you, you know, what jobs they have available, you know, what majors they might be looking for, if they're concerned about that, class years, what sessions that they have going on, so on and so forth. But two things is you can click on their logo and that'll bring you to their informational page. And Handshake also does things like Glassdoor where students leave reviews, interview questions, your fellow students or people from other schools who have worked here that could tell you about them, other position postings that they have, things like that. And of course, if it's a place you're really interested in, you could follow them. And one thing I didn't realize, I was following, you know, Aflac on here, and the second that their registration got approved for the career fair, I got an email telling me that Aflac was attending the career fair. So it can even just do things like that. So the next time that they have a campus event or something like that, you get an email alert from Handshake if they're a target organization that you had there. So that'll allow you to look through all of that and the details that are going to be there. Now, one other page that I'll show before I get to questions is on, 1 second, it's on our Career Services website. And so when you log into your MyBSU and you go to Departments Career Services, that'll get you to our page. the link to log into Handshake's right there. And if you haven't been on before, your username is your full at studentupridgew.edu email address and the password that goes with that, and that will get you into Handshake. And if you've never been in, it'll have you fill in some missing details and ask you to upload your resume. But on here, when you click on the link or something, it'll bring you right to the event page. But this link here that I will put on the event page right before is our virtual affairs page. And on here, we just added some additional details. So based on other schools that have already run virtual fairs and some of the issues they've had, I've tried to put on some info for you all, you know, things to think about prior to the event to get ready, how to register. There's even a video showing you basically what I just showed you, but in a little bit more detail. Issues with testing and prepping your software, and some frequently asked questions that have come up and things along the way. So that way you've got that to go on, as well as links to our Career Spot video series on virtual career fairs, professional attire, and things like that. So just a few other resources that you can use right off of there, off of our website. So now let's see, as I take a look at questions, Carla, are other pieces or notes or things that you think that we missed along the way?
The only thing that I would like to add is to remember that it's okay to be nervous in an interview. You know, everyone is nervous. I've been interviewing people for a lot of years, and whether you're just starting to interview or you're a senior level person, people are nervous and it's okay, you know, but just try to remember that, you know, you're there telling your story. It's a two-way conversation. And if you're nervous, it's okay. I think recruiters just kind of expect that. So don't be too concerned about that. It's okay.
All right. One question that we have is a specific question. So as an international student, seeing that a lot of companies are requiring U.S. citizenship work authorization for positions and kind of what to do. So one thing I would say is you can definitely always contact our office to set up a one-on-one appointment to kind of talk a little bit more about your job search, about, you know, targeting particular types of companies, organizations that may be a good fit there. I think a lot of it right now is the pressure of the current economy, especially is constricting some of the options that employers have had. But we can definitely talk about what are potentially some of the options, and obviously also talking through with International Student Services about any of your visa status and what you can do in terms of, you know, work requirement backgrounds, you know, what sort of practical skills, training, internships, and things that you can do along the way. So, and I don't know if you have any other advice that you would share, Carla, in kind of that area. Yeah.
No, I think that is great advice. You know, there definitely are, you know, some organizations out there that do a lot more of that, you know, working with students that need visas than others. So just kind of researching that and looking into that and working with career services, I think is, you know, great advice.
All right. Any other questions that people have? And if you're having any issues with the chat box, feel free to unmute yourself and pop on if you need to, because we have a few more moments. Okay, another question. Would you suggest a returning student who's a bit older than the typical intern candidate to approach the one-on-one meetings differently? I'll let you answer this, Carl, mostly, but I would say probably not. And it's just that you're going to have some more experience and life experience to talk about. And it's still going to be targeting, you know, of the skills and experiences that you've had along the way, what are going to be the most pertinent to the particular organization. And I think most, and Carly can correct me if I'm wrong, most aren't going to be necessarily concerned about that, necessarily having more of the work history. They're, you know, it's more going to be how it's connecting to your organization.
Yeah, that's, I think that's the perfect answer, because, you know, as you mentioned, you'll have, you know, a lot of great experience to talk about. And we actually, at one of our Bridgewater State, you know, career fairs, we were able to, we actually hired someone who had, you know, worked in a different type of career for many years and then went back and got her degree and actually is working for us. So, you know, I think it can be just a great asset to be able to, you know, talk about that great experience. And like I said, I know we here have quite a few employees that this is kind of like a change in career for them. So I think there's lots of, you know, great things that you can really talk about there that can be very exciting for an employer to listen to. Absolutely.
And in terms of intern candidates, same thing, I would assume, whether it's a full-time hire intern, you'd feel the same way in terms of the approach.
Absolutely. Okay. Sure. Yeah.
Excellent. Okay. We have another moment or two. So are there any other final questions that anybody has, maybe specifically for Carla, me, or about the virtual fair this week? Well, I'll give you another minute to type if you have anything. So I'll go through kind of my final spiel. So as I was mentioning, I will send these materials to you. I will send the copy of the PowerPoint presentation and our resume writing guide. And it might be tomorrow morning, just to give me time to be able to get the video uploaded onto our YouTube channel as well. But I'll provide that to all of you in a follow-up email. But in terms of next steps, like I said, first would definitely be the registering for the sessions, taking a look through, working on the resume. And as I said, if you want to try and get it looked at, there might be a few last minute appointments early on Wednesday morning before the fair. But again, if it doesn't fit with your schedule, just set up something right after. So that way you have time to edit it before maybe you do your follow-ups with the employers. So definitely do that. Look through and register, and we'll be sending out, you know, any final reminders to the registered students. And as mentioned, right on the homepage for the event, the morning of the event, I will update some of the details to kind of have some of those frequently asked questions, links to some of those important things like testing the software, so on and so forth. So that way you don't have to go to 12 different websites or places to go. So I know there's a lot of links and information to go through. We're all navigating it together as well right now. So we're just hoping that this will be a good opportunity for all of you to still be able to connect with some of our local employer partners who have openings for you all. So if you do have questions, our office number will be on everything, but it's 508-531-1328. And again, if you go on to your MyBSU and log in, you can go to Department's Career Services, or you can find our link in the student employment section on there, and that'll bring you right to our website that has the Handshake login and all sorts of those details on there. And so I don't see any other questions in there right now. So if questions do come to mind, you know, you'll have my email, everybody, that you can reach out to me. But otherwise, right now, I'd like to thank Carla for her time today and for joining us, and for all of you for participating, and want to wish you luck in attending at the virtual career fair now or and or future ones down the line, and we look forward to working with you all. Okay.
Right.
All right, everybody, have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.